Before I get into it, I just want to let you know that I've got a Discord server now, so if you feel like stopping by and saying hi, that'd be great. Links in the description. Now, if you've watched many of my videos, you might have picked up on the fact that music is very important to me. A large chunk of the fond nostalgia I have for Mega Drive Sonic games comes down to the excellent soundtracks, and Final Fantasy music can still fill me with some pretty profound emotions. Of course, there's so much music from outside the gaming world that I also love, encompassing all genres, ranging from classical to hip-hop, and from traditional folk music to avant-garde electronica. But perhaps my favourite music of all time, or at least from my lifetime, has been created by the British electronica outfit Underworld. They're fairly well known in their homeland, but perhaps not so much elsewhere. You may be familiar with their work if you've seen the excellent film Trainspotting. Or if you've watched the awe-inspiring opening ceremony of the 2012 London Olympics. And they've had tunes in quite a few other films as well, especially those directed by Danny Boyle. I've absolutely loved pretty much everything they've ever done, but one of my favourite Underworld tunes is a 1993 track called Rez. It's an energetic, upbeat tune that became a popular club hit. And for a long time, I believed that the game Rez, released in 2001 for the Dreamcast and PlayStation 2, was inspired by and named after the Underworld tune, but that's not something I can verify. I definitely read that somewhere, but Wikipedia says the name simply comes from the words resolve or resolute, and was also connected to the concept of de-rezzing from the film Tron. However, it is certain that Rez the tune has a connection to Rez the game, as it was apparently used as background music while prototyping the game, and the developers wanted to use it in the final product as well, but Underworld turned them down, which is a shame. Actually, of the two Rezes, Game and Club Anthem, it was the game I became familiar with first. I played it on the Dreamcast a year or two after it was released. I didn't know much about it other than the fact that it was a game that revolved around music and that it had a small but devoted fanbase. I didn't know what to expect going in, and I suspect that was a good thing, because on its surface Rez is not necessarily the most appealing game. It's an on-rail shooter, a genre of somewhat limited appeal, and it's a very short game, with it being possible to conquer the game's 5 levels in an hour or so. Of course, that doesn't tell the whole story. So let's start with the fundamentals. There is a story here, although it's never brought to the foreground. You are a hacker, or maybe even just an AI subroutine, floating through a netherworld made up of data and software, fending off firewalls and viruses as you delve into the heart of the network, wherein dwells Eden, a slumbering cybernetic consciousness who has withdrawn from reality after realizing that the humans who created her are deeply flawed and contradictory creatures. There's not much to the narrative, but the imagery within the game is really rather intriguing and thought-provoking, especially in the final level as you approach the dormant AI and attempt to reawaken her. In terms of gameplay, Rez is a very simple on-rail shooter. You don't have direct control of your character as they drift through cyberspace, you just move the targeting reticle around, with a very limited ability to alter your viewpoint. You hold down the X button and move the reticle to tag enemies and release it to unleash a barrage of cyber attacks on those targets. You can tag up to 8 enemies at a time, or in the case of stronger enemies that take more than one hit, you can tag a single enemy up to 8 times. It's very simple stuff, but it can still feel quite dynamic. You don't have to hold down the button for very long to reach the maximum number of tagged targets, only a second or so, and if you want to reach maximum efficiency, you need to get into a rhythm of holding down the button for precisely as long as it takes to get to 8 tags, release it, then instantly press it again. This is especially important for bosses, which need to be hit repeatedly over an extended period, as if you don't kill them quickly enough, they can shut themselves down without being destroyed. This doesn't matter for the story, you still complete the stages if they just shut down, but in score attack mode, this will pretty much destroy your chances of getting a decent score. More on that later, as getting high scores is where the real meat of the game lies. Also, you need to judge when it is unwise to try tagging more than one enemy at a time, and when you're just better off pounding the attack button as rapidly as possible. The thing is, although tagging 8 enemies takes only a second or less, that can be quite a long time when you need to shoot down enemy projectiles that are heading your way. Furthermore, there is always a small delay between releasing the button and your attacks actually hitting their target, and that needs to be factored in. At the start of the game, you can only take a couple of hits before you're destroyed, and although you can find power-ups that increase the number of hits you can take, that can take a while, and you can never have enough hit points in reserve to feel totally safe. That said, Rez is not necessarily a difficult game. Enemies only occasionally launch attacks of their own, and when they do, they usually move slowly enough to give you plenty of time to shoot them down before they reach you. The thing that's most likely to cause you to take a hit is not so much enemy aggression as visual confusion, as there's often a lot going on, and picking out which objects represent a threat to your safety can be tough. You might take a few unnecessary hits on your first couple of playthroughs, but once you have a basic idea of what to expect, you should be fine, for the most part. The bosses are more aggressive and can present some minor problems, but if you play defensively, they shouldn't hold you back. Only the last boss is a significant challenge, and even that's not exactly super tough. Plus, if you ever look to be in real trouble, there are also overdrive power-ups to be collected. These basically act as a screen-clearing smart bomb and will destroy pretty much any threat headed your way, so they're a rather effective oh shit button, even if you can only hold 4 at a time, and they're not exactly abundant. And that's pretty much all there is to the gameplay. Ultimately, you just move a targeting reticle around. I know it sounds simple, but it really can be fun, and the sheer number of targets in front of you makes the game pretty frenetic at times. But yes, the gameplay is only one element of the Rez experience. The music is another, and arguably larger, element. That being the case, it has to be said that your enjoyment of Rez will probably increase or decrease in direct proportion to precisely how much you like the music. If you're not a fan of electronica in general, or the track selection of Rez specifically, you will simply not be able to properly enjoy the game. And that's absolutely fine, I've said it before, but I'm happy to stress the point. Musical taste is a deeply personal and subjective thing. As for me though, well, I suspect you can make a pretty solid guess as to whether the music of Rez is my sort of thing or not. Actually, to say it's my sort of thing is rather insufficient. I don't just like this music, I consider it to be amongst the best electronica I've ever heard. It's been a regular and popular part of my playlist since I first played the game nearly 2 decades ago, and I'll always be happy to hear it when it comes up on shuffle mode. But it's when it's absorbed as part of the gameplay experience of Rez that it's at its best. It's great to listen to on Spotify or YouTube or whatever, but it's much better to actually play through it in-game. Now, Rez is not a rhythm action game, which kind of confused me when I first played it, as I was expecting something along the lines of Space Channel 5, the previous game made by Rez designer Tetsuya Mizuguchi. You don't need to time your actions to the music in Rez. In actuality, the game takes care of that for you, as everything is choreographed, and the time it takes for your attacks to reach your enemies is adjusted slightly to make sure that everything happens in time to the music. You don't end up feeling like you're playing an instrument, as in something like Guitar Hero, but you do feel immersed in the soundscape. One of the best things about the way the game is structured is that you get to witness the music being built around you, summoned from the abstract, light-filled cyberscape. In most stages, the music starts off in a minimal form, and more instruments, melodies, and harmonies are added as you progress. I find this hugely effective, at least partially because I have a strong interest in the art that lies behind the construction of music, and to hear it building up layer by layer is something I find incredibly satisfying. So let's take a quick look and a listen to the 5 stages that make up the main game. The game starts strong. In fact, stage 1 may be my favourite. But it also starts extremely simply, both in terms of music and gameplay. This is no bad thing. Like I said, the way the music builds up is one of the most compelling elements of the game. And what it builds into is an upbeat and hugely enjoyable techno number. It doesn't do anything particularly different or unusual, it just takes some pretty basic electronica elements and combines them expertly, producing a tune that sure as hell had my toes tapping. The gameplay too starts with the absolute basics, with sets of 2 enemies, then 4, then 2 sets of 4, and so on into more complex patterns. It's teaching you how many enemies you can walk onto at the same time, and how you sometimes have to make choices about how to most efficiently dispatch your foes. Efficiency doesn't matter too much for a standard playthrough, but as I suggested earlier, it does when you're going for a high score. You see, Rez has a score multiplier system. The more enemies you kill with one attack, the more points you get. So to maximise your score, you need to be locking onto the maximum of 8 enemies as often as possible. And this is where the strategy comes in. Do you hold off on releasing your attack until you have 8 targets locked on, even though one of your targets is about to fly off screen, making it impossible to kill? Do you ignore an incoming projectile to focus on targets that are worth more points? Or can you perhaps lock on to incoming projectiles to increase your multiplier? It's not particularly complex or sophisticated stuff, but it does add a level of depth that might not be immediately apparent, and it rewards multiple playthroughs as you hone your strategies and increase your knowledge of what enemies are going to appear where, and just how far you can push your score multipliers. Anyway, back to the specifics of Stage 1. Once the music has reached its final form, it's time to face the boss. And this is the only stage, other than the fifth and final one, where the boss gets its own completely separate music. And it's another great tune, in my opinion, a sort of more threatening variation on what's come before. The strength of the bosses actually varies depending on how many enemies you've managed to shoot down in the preceding stage. There are three possible strength levels that I'm aware of: Mega, Giga, and Terra. I'd been playing the game for quite a while before I even realised there was a Terra version. And hell, for all I know, there may be something even stronger if you get a completely perfect run, which I don't think I've ever managed. In any case, even in its strongest form, this boss isn't too tough, and I managed to get through Stage 1 without taking a hit. The music of Stage 2 is a little faster, a little more frenetic, with a focus on percussion that pushes the tempo and makes the whole level feel a lot more tense than the first. The melody only slowly reveals itself, and when it does, it's simple and repetitive, leaving the tone of the level to be set through the bass and percussion. The gameplay is also getting more frenetic, with more enemies that move in more unpredictable ways, making it tough to achieve a high kill percentage without some practice. Since I'm definitely out of practice, I only managed to get to the Giga version of this boss, and I'm okay with that since the boss can be quite tricky. You need to fight through several layers of defense before you can even do any damage, and they're not usually too tough, although this sort of crystalline, branching structure can throw out projectiles that really, really need to be shot down quickly, depending on how close to you they spawn. But once the boss's core is exposed, it actually dies pretty quickly. Stage 3 starts with the bass and builds from there. It's actually kind of a wacky bassline, but it grows into another upbeat and highly enjoyable slice of electronica. Difficulty-wise, it's not really any more of a challenge than the second stage. There are still plenty of fast-moving enemies that flit about the screen, making it tough to get a high kill percentage, but there's also not much to threaten you, so long as you keep your wits about you. The boss, too, is roughly on a par with the previous one, although it is a longer fight, and there are maybe a few more opportunities to mess up. The boss essentially takes the form of a large tower, and once again you can't actually do any damage until you penetrate all its layers of defense. These fish remind me of piranhas, and they always stress me out as they sometimes get very close to you with their gaping jaws. Once you get past them though, things get easier. All you have to do is shoot the locks of the central core and do as much damage as you can before it closes again. Get to this point and you've basically won. On to Stage 4 then. This is the other contender for my favourite stage and favourite music. It's another track with a strong focus on the percussion, as it starts with a harsh driving kick drum that persists pretty much through the whole stage. Yeah. More percussion is added in, and finally some bass. But when you arrive at the boss arena, everything drops away apart from that savage, relentless beat. It's a great moment. And then the music picks up again and the boss appears. This is definitely my favourite part of the game. The boss is great, but it's the music that makes it so damn exciting, as the bass kicks in and then, in the final phase, we get some epic, crunchy guitars. Like I say, if the music in Rez doesn't appeal to you, the game isn't going to seem like much, but if it does, this is a boss fight that might live on in your memories long after you've set the controller down. And so it's on to the fifth and final stage, and this may actually be my least favourite stage. The music is down tempo and just not quite as appealing to my idiosyncratic tastes. Don't get me wrong, I still really like it, but I don't love it as much as the other tunes. It's also a longer stage than any of the others, with some callbacks to enemies you fought previously. And you're presented with text boxes here, which give you a brief description of the evolution of life, from its humble origins through to the casting off of physical forms, as humanity transcends the material plane and becomes a digital civilization, culminating in the birth of Eden, the AI that we, the player, are trying to reawaken. These concepts, evolution and transcendence, run throughout the entire game, in various subtle ways. They are perhaps most apparent in the different forms the player character takes as they accrue power-ups, from a rudimentary human form at the beginning of the game, through to more advanced human forms, and ultimately to an abstract, decidedly non-human shape, something like a pulsing proton with a core of pure blackness. Now, once you finally reach Eden, you're granted one more form, that of a baby, suggesting rebirth into a new form of being, and I'm sure I'm not the only one reminded of 2001: A Space Odyssey. Unfortunately, it's tough to hold on to your newfound babyhood for long because the final boss fight is a real endurance test, and a tough one at that, and any damage you take will drop you down to a lower plane of existence. It is still possible to acquire power-ups, allowing you to regain your childlike form, but that's no mean feat. To begin with, Eden is scared of you, and you're forced to face modified versions of each of the four bosses you've fought so far. I went through my entire supply of overdrive power-ups and still got hit a few times. Then at last, the final boss fight properly starts, and honestly, it's a little disappointing. For the first time in the game, the music, a minimalist high-tension track, is kind of relegated to the background, only coming to the fore as you reconstruct another section of Eden's consciousness. Plus, the fight is confusing as it's tough to know what you're supposed to be aiming for, and seemingly important targets often dart out of your line of sight, which is heavily restricted at times by the edges of the arena. Apparently, if you complete this fight while retaining your final cyber baby form, you get the true ending. I have never managed that. To be honest, I've never tried super hard. This last stage is frustrating enough that, although I mostly enjoy it, I've never really felt like making the effort necessary to master it. And that's it, the credits roll, and because I suck, they tell me that Eden is still trapped within the system. That's annoying, but oh well. That's the end of the main game, but there's also the Beyond mode, which lets you mess with some of the settings, and which includes one bonus stage to play through. This stage has a nifty little tune of its own, not quite on the same level as the other tracks, but I like it. There's no boss through this level though, so on the whole, it's not very memorable. And then there's this cacophony. It's listed as another bonus stage, but I'm honestly not sure what this is supposed to be, whether it's intended as a joke, or if someone with really, really unusual musical taste thought it was genuinely a pleasant sound. This stage has no end, and there's nothing to kill you, there's no representation of the player, there's just a never-ending stream of enemies to kill if you wanted to, for some reason. Unsurprisingly, perhaps, there's a bunch of theories online as to what's really going on here, and I have found myself wondering if you process these sounds in the right way, maybe they'd reveal something more. And that's basically the end of Res. But this is Res Infinite, the 2016 re-release, and it's got one little added extra, and it's awesome. This is Area X, a completely new level built from the ground up using Unreal Engine 4. It's got particle effects out the yin-yang, and a brilliant soundtrack that passes through a number of different styles and moods, culminating in a vocal track that plays over the credits. It's essentially the same game, but you have more agency in this version, as you can turn freely and accelerate forwards as necessary. It looks great, it sounds great, and I consider it well worth buying this updated version of the game for this level alone. In short, I love it. I also hate it. Not because of what it is fantastic, but it's a huge frustrating tease. This is what a new Res game could be like. Five levels along these lines would blow my mind and be a day one purchase for me, even if, like the original Res, the whole thing only took an hour to get through. But it doesn't seem like we're ever going to get a Res 2, and that's a real shame. Incidentally, I am indeed aware of Child of Eden, which in many ways was a spiritual successor to Res, if not an outright sequel. I bought it on PS3 for full price the day it was released. I strongly suspect I was the only person in the world to do so, because I have literally never seen a game relegated to the bargain bin so quickly. Within months it was selling for less than a fifth of its release price, and within a year or two it was selling for a dollar. A dollar. I paid 90 bucks for it. I even saw it on sale once for 50 cents. I bought another copy of it at that price just to see if the guy at EB Games would try to sell me the $1 scratch protection on a game that cost 50 cents. He did. That almost made it all worthwhile. Actually, now I think of it, maybe it was DJ Hero 2 I bought a second copy of for 50 cents. But let's say it was Child of Eden, so I can keep this pointless anecdote in the video. Well, thanks for watching. Don't forget about the Discord server if you feel like joining, the more the merrier. Plus you can follow me on Twitter, and if you really want to support the channel, you can donate at ko-fi.com. All the links are in the description. And oh yeah, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. But once you've done all that, you know what you gotta do. Get off my lawn.